What is all the fuss about Hong Kong's shiny new Palace Museum? How about unprecedented access to hundreds of priceless treasures on loan from China's Forbidden City? Or the chance of a lifetime to appreciate works of art dating back thousands of years?
Okay, I don't know anything about this, Louis, but I'm already going, wow.
Many of the precious artefacts in Hong Kong's $450 million Palace Museum have never been seen outside mainland China. And some are on public display for the first time ever.
What I think really we want is to, I think, provide opportunity, platform for our visitor to appreciate art and culture, our history, our heritage.
Talking Post was given special access to the newly opened museum. Our tour guide, Museum Director Louis Ng.
We kept everything in secret for the better protection, you know, the security of these national treasures.
In this episode of Talking Post, come with us behind the scenes to understand what the museum is all about and why it matters so much.
So wow, Louis, I'm not much of a museum person, that's full disclosure, I'm being honest with you, but this place feels special. Why should people come to this particular museum when you already have a parent museum in Beijing and another one in Taipei? What's so special about the Hong Kong Museum?
This will be a global museum for the promotion of Chinese art and culture while advancing dialogue among world civilizations. As the third Palace Museum in China showing national treasures, we have to differentiate ourselves. We have a very distinct identity being a connected museum. I think the concept being a connected museum is very, very important. How we connect the past and the present, and how we bridge the Forbidden City in Beijing with Hong Kong and the world.
Using your cultural heritage as the starting point, this is a force for positivity, right, in Hong Kong?
Yeah, of course. I think this is quite unusual that the Palace Museum Beijing, you know, has agreed to loan us so many, you know, that national treasures. We are talking about 900, and most of them, you know, that are very, very high grade, we call grade one, you know, regarded as a national treasures. This is my favorite item. So it's so lovely. It's a pillow or a headrest. It was made at Song Dynasty. At that time, you know,
so
that.
How many years old was this?
Oh, this is about over 1,000 years old.
This is more of an object, right? Rather than for utility. I mean, I can imagine people using.
Both.
For both?
Both. It's quite popular at that time, you know, that they make this, you know, that pillow, a porcelain pillow. But this one especially, I think, make for the emperors. We have a very, very important ancient paintings dated back to 1,000 years ago. Of course, I can appreciate, you know, the beauty, you know, the skill, I think the painter appoint. But I think to me, I can also feel the history. This is a icebox, I think, made during the Qianlong period.
So this is an ancient fridge?
And the fridge and air conditioner. During the summertime, they cut the ice and then put it inside.
This is used by the last emperor of China.
Yes. And then the last emperor, I think, liked it very much. When he was ordered to evacuate from the Forbidden City, he brought this, I think, to his new home in Tianjin. And then finally, I think that it was sold to somebody, and eventually it was, I think, that's donated to the Palace Museum, back to the palace again.
What about acquiring treasures that have been stolen from China over the hundreds of years? They're all over Europe, they're all over the place.
There are hidden debates, you know, about the repatriations of cultural properties. not only Chinese, you know, that in other countries, there's you know, that whether this type of looted cultural property should be returned to the original city, the museum. So I think to me as a Chinese curator, I, you know, that I'm in support of this, you know, that this our obligation, I think, to me, to have the return of those cultural property we lost, I think, in the past.
Talking about national treasures that have been taken away from Beijing, you also mentioned that there are three palace museums.
Mm-hmm.
So the one in Taipei.
Yeah.
That's historically, if you look at that, that's the one where the nationalists were. People say that they took the cream of the crop when they opened the palace museum in Taipei.
Yeah.
Any chance of cooperation with them so that we can get to see in Hong Kong some of the priceless treasures they
have?
Of course.
Of course, there were collaboration between the Beijing and Taipei in the past. Understanding that the artifacts from Beijing, you know, they were displayed in Taipei. I think that we look forward to this opportunity. Of course, I think we will, you know, discuss with the past museum because we don't have any, you know, the collection items. You know, if there were a proposal, they are willing to be part of these kind of collaborations.
So this is obviously a political issue. I mean, it's not for a museum to decide, but that kind of cooperation would be a good step forward in cultural exchanges, right?
Of course.
Peacemaking.
Yes, of course, you know, that we don't have any political label, you know, that for our cultural heritage, you know, that it's lasts for, you know, 1,000 years, I think. What we want is to, I think, provide opportunity, platform for our visitor to appreciate art and culture, our history, you know, our heritage.
Isn't Hong Kong perfectly placed to leverage itself as an international city to do more of these cooperative exhibitions,
where
you get to procure treasures that are lost in Europe?
Yeah. Of course, I think there is also our missions. There's in future, we will have exhibition on past museum culture, and also we are going to promote a dialogue among world civilizations. Under our exhibition plan, we will have many world civilizations and also exhibition about cultural exchange.
Wow.
This is also made under the order of Louis the 14th. Actually, he communicated with the Emperor Kanxi at the time. The two emperors communicate, you know, that. And I think this is a this tapestry depicts a war in 200 BC. You can see Roman generals. We at the Palace Museum has a very, very good network with those overseas museum, Louvre, the British Museum, you know, the V&A. That they are willing, I think, to loan us the objects and discuss with art in future, this kind of exchange, cultural exchange projects.
You're talking about so many priceless treasures on display in this museum. That's a huge responsibility, right? You don't want to drop or break anything.
Yeah, I think that's, you know, that actually, I think that we were under great pressure when we shipped these, you know, 900 objects to Hong Kong.
What was that like? That must be a logistical nightmare.
Yes.
So much tension. What was that?
And also during the COVID situation.
Yes.
That's, you know, that's this exercise, you know, that's unprecedented, you know, arrangement since the Palace Museum was established in 1925.
How did you go about it? How did you bring these treasures across?
We have planned this, I think, almost 6 months. We sent my museum colleagues to work with the curatorial team in Palace Museum, you know, about the packing, you know, and the shipping. And we shipped these 900, you know, the items to Hong Kong in 5 batches. We kept everything in secret. We didn't want to disclose the route, the timing, for the better protection, you know, the security of these national treasures.
Nothing got broken on the way?
No.
Okay, I don't know anything about this, Louis, but I'm already going, wow.
Yeah.
The sheer size of this is so imposing.
The magnificent, you know, printing.
So this is a Chinese treasure with international characteristics.
Yes, yes, yes. It was printed by an Italian artist called Cassioni. He came to China during the Chanong period as age of 25, and then stayed in China in the imperial court as the imperial painters until, you know, then he died at 78. An Italian spent whole life in China.
You know, the response to this museum is huge. I can see that already. You already have what you might call a good problem, right? People are scalping tickets.
So. Yes, yes, yes.
So this is a huge hit with Hong Kong people. But at the same time, you do realize that there is a big demographic in Hong Kong where they treat everything from mainland China in suspicion. They even talk about boycotting this museum.
Yeah.
What would you say to them?
Well, I think that since we opened the museum in early July, I didn't hear any sort of suspicions, you know, because, you know, that I can see, you know, the many smiling face, you know, the happy face from my visitors, 5,000 a day, you know, they enjoyed very much on their visit to the museum. So I think to me, I feel very, very, you know, the happy and honored to provide this museum, I think, to enlighten, I think, their cultural life.
Hong Kong is actually a center. It's a hub, so to speak, of cultural exchanges in the form of artifacts and precious antiques that are sold very often in auction. Couldn't this palace museum be built into something much bigger by tapping into that resource there?
In the past 4 months, we have been approached by some local collectors. They like our visions, you know, that, and our positioning. So they generously donate their collection to us. So far, we have acquired 5 badges, over 1,000, you know, items. Whether it's some gold and silver items, some porcelains, some furniture and printings. So we are still dealing with, I think, many acquisition proposals because we don't have money to acquire items. So we are very, you know, excited about, you know, the support from the these local collectors.
I'll have to go out there and tell people after today that believe the hype, this Palace Museum is really something. Thank you very much, Lucy.
Thank you, Dan.